Hi, guys. It's Joe Tomaso from the 15 Minutes With podcast. Our show is geared toward helping to keep not only teens, but people in general out of our jails and prisons. Our show is unique in the fact that we use real inmates throughout the country, and they explain not only about the cases that caused their incarceration, but why it's so important for people to stay out of prison and remain free. Speaking of free, have you heard about the newest and best way to put your podcast out there for the world to hear? Let me tell you about Anchor. Anchor is the easiest way to produce and distribute your ideas, your podcast, and the best part, it's free. There's even a creation tool that allows you to record and edit your podcast right from your phone or your computer. Anchor will even distribute your podcast for you so people can hear it on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and many other listening platforms. You can even make money from your podcast, and there are no minimal amount of listeners required. Anchor is everything you need to make a podcast in one place. So what are you waiting for? Download the free Anchor app or go to anchor.fm and get started. Hey, everyone, and welcome to this edition of the 15 Minutes with True Crime podcast. I am Dr. Joe Tomaso, your host. Naomi Heater was 27 years old when she became enraged at her adopted parents for taking away her car. She fatally shot her mother in the chest, killing her almost instantly. She then turned the weapon on her disabled 63-year-old father, hitting him in the arm. She also hit him in the head with a frying pan, forced him into a closet, and nailed the door shut and piled furniture against it so he could not escape. For her crimes, she was sentenced to life without parole for murder with special circumstances and an additional 24 years consecutive. Please listen to Naomi as she shares her story in this segment. If you like this show and you would like to see it continue and get better, please consider donating to paypal.me/Joe Tomaso. That is paypal.me/JoeTomaso. And hit that like and subscribe button. If you have any questions, comments, or suggestions, or if there's someone you might want us to try and interview, please email us at insidetherazorwire@gmail.com. Once again, that is insidetherazorwire@gmail.com, or you can snail mail us at P.O. Box 162. West Haven, Connecticut 06516. And now, without further ado, here is this edition of 15 Minutes With. Hello.
This is Global Tel Link. You have a prepaid call from
Naomi Heater,
an inmate at the Central California Women's Facility, Chowchilla, California. This call and your telephone number will be monitored and recorded. To accept this call, say or dial 5 now. Thank you for using Global Tel Link.
Hey, good afternoon, Naomi. How are you?
Good. How are you?
Okay. I'm sure Michelle told you I was going to ask you some questions. I don't know if she shared them with you or not. I'm going to start asking you the questions. I need you to say your name and where you're calling from.
Okay. Naomi Heater from California.
Okay, and you are currently at CCWF, correct? In Chowchilla?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay, so I'm going to ask you, what were you charged with? What was your sentence? You know, what were you actually sentenced for, I should say? Because, you know, they sometimes plea bargain and change the charges. So, and what is your actual sentence?
My actual sentence is 24 years consecutive with life without. Mm-hmm. I was charged with murder in the first degree with a special circumstance, which was attempted robbery.
Okay. How long have you been in prison right now?
23 years.
So you went in right around, say, 1998?
Yes.
Okay. You were in county jail before you went to prison, or...?
I was only in county jail for about a year and a half fighting my case.
Wow.
So I got there, I think, about maybe 97. At the beginning of somewhere in 98, but I wasn't there for very long at all.
Okay. What was your, when you first, you know, went into jail and prison, especially prison, what was your first reaction? Like, what was that first feeling?
Well, my first reaction going into jail was, it was a very judgmental place, because as soon as you walk in, it's your guilty. It doesn't matter who you are, what you are, what you have.
Mm-hmm.
Once I came to prison, I kind of felt the same, too, because it's like, and now you've actually been found guilty of a crime,
mm-hmm.
and you walk into a place where you're looked at as if you're a piece of garbage.
Right.
You know? I mean, I realize that we've done something, but I still feel like there should still be somewhat of a human factor involved in it.
Absolutely. A lot of people lose the sight of the fact that just because a person is convicted of a crime, no matter what the crime is, you're still a human being. So, a lot of people have seen shows on TV like 60 Days In, Lock Up. I don't know if you've seen any of these shows yourself, but the shows are pretty sanitized. They don't show, you know, reality. You know, they make it look like it's okay. There's hardly any fights. There's hardly anything that goes on in there. You're in there. You're in a, you know, female facility, which is a little bit different than the men's. But would you describe where you're at as more of a college campus, or would you say that prison itself is actually a pretty dangerous place? And I'm not just talking about where you are now. I'm talking about overall, like the max facilities and stuff like that.
I think in general, like, I agree with you that some movies do glamorize prison, like it's fun and it's college, but I've been in prison. Prison is prison. Prison is very dangerous because even though we're women,
mm-hmm.
still manipulate, and still women are still finding victims. They're trying to find people who they can victimize and manipulate in some way, and doing the same things. Maybe it's not as violent as like mm-hmm. in a men's prison,
mm-hmm.
but it's very, very... It's violent in a different way. It's not like the physical violence.
Mm-hmm.
It's more of the emotional, because there's a lot of emotional abuse.
Would you say just like a men's prison where like the violence, you know, the actual violence is, but with the women's prison and even prison in general, that it's pretty much set up like predator and prey?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Okay. And sometimes I think in a women's prison, there's more predators looking for a prey.
Wow.
It's not because we're women.
Right. I mean, I was actually surprised. I know when I was younger, we used to talk about the percentage of men in prison for crimes versus women, and it was like, I think it was 25% at that time. And I mean, I've talked to a lot of, you know, females, and, you know, there's a lot of, you know, females in prison now. I'm just like, it's not like it used to be, that's for sure. My next question to you is, what would you say to a young person, or just a person in general, who they're on the outside, but they're screwing up, they're getting involved with the law, they're getting involved with court, they're doing things wrong, they might be doing drugs, you know, what would you tell them about what they should do, or like a, you don't want to wind up in prison because...
I think for me, what I would tell someone is there's options, because a lot of times when we do the things we do, we don't realize there's options.
Mm-hmm.
Someone who is going down the wrong path, whether it's drugs, alcohol, or robbing, killing, whatever the case may be,
mm-hmm.
a lot of times it's we're a product of our environment. A lot of times it's family members that have been doing that, it's been friends, whatever, we're trying to fit in.
Mm-hmm.
And I think there comes a time we need to fit in with ourselves, not with what our peers want, or what even what society wants.
Mm-hmm.
We have to do what's best for us, and I think a lot of people forget that.
I want you to tell me about you. Tell me your story, basically, and then how you wound up in prison.
Okay, I was adopted long, long time ago, probably in 1971 from Korea with a Caucasian man and a Japanese mother.
Okay.
We came to the United States. I'm trying to do it fast because I know we don't have a lot of time.
Mm-hmm.
But anyways, in the long run, what it was is both of my adopted parents were very abusive.
Mm-hmm.
He was sexually, emotionally, and physically. She was emotionally and physical. So what brought me to prison is holding in everything that has happened to me pertaining to my adopted parents.
This call and your telephone number will be monitored and recorded.
I killed my adopted mom and attempted to kill my adopted dad.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I held on to so much anger, and I didn't have anybody to talk to. I didn't have, like, an outlet of any sort.
Mm.
So because there was so much violence around me, I just did exactly what I saw.
Right.
What they did to me is what I did to them. You know, they hurt me, I hurt them, you know.
How many years would you say the abuse went on?
It's my earliest memory was at age 4, and it went on until about 15. When I finally couldn't take it, and I told a school counselor. Mm-hmm. So I went to the group homes and foster homes for a little while.
Mm-hmm.
But then after that, they kick you out of the system when you're of age and you have nowhere to go. You have no skills. You have nothing. So I went back to my abusers.
Right. Yep.
I had nowhere to go. You know, so I went back to them. And the first thing that he told me was, tell her I did nothing to you. I didn't have an option at the time because I had nowhere to go.
Right.
I said that. I said, he did nothing to me. So I stayed there. I finally got my first job making $4.75, and then I heard and got enough money to get me the most low-budget apartment there was just to get out of there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that's pretty much what my life has been, is just, my life has always been just surviving.
Right.
I've just survived. I've had good jobs. I've had where I've had a lot of money. I've had jobs where I've had nothing, you know, but I've just been like in survival mode for a long time.
Right. What do you miss most on the outside being in there?
I miss my son.
Okay.
You know, my son is 29 now. So I left him when he was about 5.
Okay.
So I miss my son. And
Can I ask you a question? Have you had contact with your son since you've been in prison?
I met my son in 2012. I met him in like June of 2012.
Okay.
Because he had a wife who said, no, you need to go talk to your mom. So
right.
He agreed. He came to visit me. He talked to me. Well, the first hour, he just stared at me. So then the last couple hours, he talked to me. And then he didn't really ask me much. You know, he didn't really talk to me about much, just kind of stared at what was prison life like.
Mm-hmm.
And then after that, when he went home with his wife, he told his wife he didn't want nothing to do with me. You know, because I know it's his grandma, and that's all he had, like, on my side.
Right, right.
My brothers and sisters. So, you know, and he loved her, and she loved him.
Right.
So.
I gotcha. If you can go back in time and you could see yourself, you know, before everything happened, then, you know, that led up to this, what would you say to a younger you?
I would have said, I would have told myself to open my mouth sooner. I should have opened it when the first time something happened, whether it's to, you know, one of my friend's mothers and fathers said, hey, do you do this to your, you know, just something, where I would have opened my mouth sooner. Because I think if I would have opened my mouth, then I could have gotten help. But when you don't open your mouth, even when I was only 4 or 5 years old, but I know something didn't make me feel right. So maybe if I would have went and talked to or asked a question of some sort, maybe I wouldn't be where I was, you know, where I'm at.
I got you. Okay, I want to ask you, this is kind of a double question. So the first one is, do you have any advice for people who might be doing things wrong or going through something similar to you? And also,
this call and your telephone number will be monitored and recorded.
And also, is there anything that you would like to tell the people listening, a message from you to people listening?
I would tell them is, whatever's going on in your life, find the core as to what started it and what happened. Huh? You signed up, there's no one underneath me. Oh my goodness, this is... Okay, oh my gosh. I'm going to have to call you back, because this...
Okay, it's fine.
It's our phone time.
All right, thanks.
Okay.
Thank you for listening to 15 Minutes With. I hope you've enjoyed this edition. If you have enjoyed this edition of 15 Minutes With, please hit the like and the subscribe button. You can also help me keep this show going and watch it get better by donating to paypal.me/JoeTomaso. That address again is paypal.me/JoeTomaso. 15 Minutes With is constantly looking for new content to upload and new people to interview. If you would like to share your story, or if there's someone you would like to see us interview, please email us at insidetherazorwire@gmail.com. That email address again is insidetherazorwire@gmail.com. Last but not least, again, if you like to support this channel, please subscribe and hit the like button. Until next time, we'll be seeing you.